welcome you to this special conversation that we promised with the JP Morgan Brains Trust. Joining us now are Kalpana Morparia, CEO, South and Southeast Asia, Bharat Iyer, Head of Equity Research, and Sajjid Chinoy, Chief India Economist at JP Morgan. Thank you very much, all of you, for joining us in this very special edition. Well, let me start with you, Bharat. The Indian markets have actually done very well, considering that last week we saw resignation of a governor and we saw the ruling party lose out on three key states. We've actually outperformed. What's the message? Is it that you're expecting stimulus, or is there some growth story that we are factoring in?
Well, Latha, I guess, you know, the fundamental backdrop is better than it's been in a long time. I mean, you've seen oil correct by more than 30%. You've seen a very meaningful rally in both the bond market and the currency market. And specific to the equity markets, if you see, you've got two quarters of 15% plus earnings growth, which we have not seen in a long time. I think the outlook for earnings over the second half also looks good. You have an easy base effect in the fourth quarter. There is scope for margin improvement given that commodity prices have rolled over, interest rates have come down. And valuations are at 17 times forward earnings and the long-term average is 16. So, you know, you have a scenario where positioning is light, valuations are well anchored, earnings are coming back, and the macro backdrop is good. So I think the rally is justified.
I want to ask you the same thing, Kalpana. You've seen many cycles of bank cleanup and interest rate cycles. Where do you think we are? Or does it feel like 2003 when, you know, the cleanup was over and we also had an interest rate tailwind? What does it feel like?
It feels more like 2003 to me.
Oh, then we are.
Because certainly, certainly on the asset quality, I think we've seen the trough. Now I think the entire focus is going to be in terms of growth. And we've seen great growth in consumer credit. We still need to see the private investment cycle pick up. And, you know, once this restructuring and whatever M&A on the distressed assets is done, you will initially see a cycle of investment in those assets, and eventually we will see a private investment cycle pick up.
Okay, so pick up in the private investment cycle. That's what a lot of people have told us. By the way, greetings of the season to all of you, and thank you for joining us. Sajjid, so much has happened in the last fortnight, right? I mean, global growth slowdown, a governor has resigned, BJP lost in the elections, and now farm loan waivers. What would the overarching theme be in the start of 2019, you think, from a macro standpoint?
Yeah, well, just spend a minute looking globally, because I think things have also changed quite dramatically globally. There's clearly a strong disinflationary tilt globally as well, and growth is poised to slow quite meaningfully. The December PMIs globally were the weakest in 2 years. So what you're seeing is the US fiscal stimulus is fading, Europe continues to surprise to the downside, and China is struggling to hold on to 6% growth. So our sense is that's the sobering news globally. The good news is many of the event risks, the geopolitical risks related to the Iran sanctions, the US-China tariffs have faded, if not disappeared. And I think the big event of the week will be the US Fed. The sense is this will be a dovish hike and a very good chance that the dot plot for 2019 will move from 3 hikes to 2 hikes. If that were to happen, I think that provides a much more conducive environment for emerging markets. When it comes to India, I think, again, similar dynamics at play. Inflation significantly undershooting. I mean, who would have thought in a year where you had the highest MSP increase in 6 years that food would be in deflation in the month of December? And my suspicion now is that in the next 6 months, the headline inflation is poised to undershoot even the RBI's downward revised trajectory for the next 2 months. So I think we'll enter 2019 with a sigh of relief that many of these global risks and domestic risks have not panned out. So far, the growth numbers are doing surprisingly well. The October IP number, if you look at the PMIs, they're holding up well. But my sense is we should brace ourselves for a little bit of a softening in the second half because the terms of trade facing agriculture are very adverse. So I think rural consumption will not pick up like we thought. And I think the government is serious about sticking to its fiscal deficit target. That may entail some expenditure compression in the coming months.
Oh, really? I was going to ask you about the fiscal deficit question the other way around. Yes. We are seeing competitive farm loan waivers. Yes. There is a fear that something big might come even from the center in terms of probably a loan write-off. We don't know. Do you think that, that will come back to bite us?
I think there are two different parts. One is what we do to this year's fiscal, which is the actual numbers on the ground. And I think my sense is the government is very serious. This is not a global environment, despite the fact that risks have faded, to be adventurous. And I think we'll stick very close to the 3.3% number. What's in the budget is a different matter. But remember, there's also another budget in July. And that's the one that really counts, because it's that budget that has to make the numbers add up. The sense in previous elections is, you know, let's not take the promises that are made in the next 6 months too seriously. What will matter is the events that happen in the 6 months subsequent to that. The last thing I'll say is many states do promise farm loan waivers, but if you look at the data carefully, Latha, not many of these get translated into large allocations in the budget, right? Because when we look at the fine print, they're staggered over many years, there are more conditionalities attached. So state deficits are a problem, but the farm loan translation from announcement to allocation is actually smaller.
Okay, Bharat, I'm going to ask you about the rural themes, because, you know, that is the eventual relationship that everyone ties in. More, more boost for the farm income and then perhaps the rural stocks. But before that, what's your own Sensex target by the end of 2019?
We have a Nifty target for June 2019, which is 11,500 to 12,000.
Okay, and where do you think the leaders could emerge from?
I think it'll be the financials. Particularly the banks. Because, Sonia, as you'll appreciate, the banks have two tailwinds emerging for them. One is loan growth is coming back very meaningfully, partially because, you know, the wholesale funded markets and NBFCs seem to be receding a tad. And secondly, credit cycle issues are being resolved. So I think it's a very powerful combination.
Okay, now coming to that question on the rural growth. I mean, is it too simplistic to assume that rural stocks are going to move up because of the boost that the government might give?
Well, Sonia, I think, you know, we really have to appreciate that rural India is actually, you know, the correlation with agriculture for rural India is weakening a tad. I mean, if you go back 15 years, 20 years, a typical rural household would derive 80 to 85% of its income from the farm and 15 to 20% of its income from non-farm sources. Now, depending on the state you are in, the rural household typically derives 25 to 40% of its income from the farm and the rest is non-farm. So, you know, I think that correlation is weakening. So, I think, you know, rural consumption, if you see, that space has been holding out despite a lot of volatility on the farm sector side. So, I think, you know, we have to appreciate that nuance that's come across.
You know, Kalpana, we have to give at least a 10% chance to a non-BJP government. We don't know how things will plan out. And there have been many instances where state government election results are not replicated in the center. But if we do see, a coalition government, do you think that disturbs either growth or markets very seriously?
I believe if you look at historical data, India has seen one of its fastest growth cycles in coalition governments. So, it doesn't really matter. It'll be headlines, markets will be volatile for a time, and then we get down to the core issue of what's driving this economy. You know, Bharat talked to you about how rural India is changing in terms of diversification of farm income. We are all completely underestimating what digitization is doing to. You know, earlier you talked about farm loan waivers and will the central government not be tempted to do the same. There are multiple ways now in which you can do targeted transfer of money to individuals who are truly disadvantaged. Mm-hmm. Because of any particular monsoon cycle or even otherwise. So I continue to remain bullish, and I think so far my bullishness is borne out.
Okay, actually, you know, all these past 4-5 years, we have seen reasonable GDP growth and flat earnings growth. If you took all the Nifty companies or all, say, chosen top 100 companies. Will this be the year when GDP may flatter to dizzy, may not be very good, but earnings will fire finally?
I think we're already seeing the evidence, Latha. The first two quarters, as I mentioned, we've got 15% plus growth in both quarters. And you're right. See, what happened is, what one needs to appreciate is, if you look at the Nifty, I mean, just as an example, roughly 40% of the Nifty's earnings actually have little to do with India. They're denominated in foreign currency. You're looking at technology, healthcare, you're looking at the resources space, etc. So, you know, they tend to be more linked to the global cycle rather than the local cycle. And as far as the local cycle was concerned, you know, you had a lot of adjustment going on, particularly in terms of credit cycle issues. And, you know, that seems to be ebbing right now. So I think that's going to be a very positive driver.
Okay. What about flows? Mm-hmm. We've not been the recipient of big flows from FIIs. There have been some months in the, some days in the last few weeks where we have seen positive flows, but as a whole, you know, we have been supported by domestic flows. Will this pattern continue to hold? Can it hold? Do you have that much faith in domestic savings?
Well, I think as far as domestic savings are concerned, you know, as households in India are typically underinvested in equities by a long way. And I know this again plays into...
That is an eternal truth.
Yeah, but
will the flows of 2018, the pattern we saw of equity flows, you have faith that will...
I think there is. We should have faith in it because, Latha, let's appreciate it. We've seen two strong sell-offs even this year.
One between
March, April, which aggregated 15%, and one over September, October, which aggregated 15%. And the domestic household kept the faith in equities. The money kept going. So I think, you know, this is part of demographics, isn't it? Overwhelming part of the population is young, they have more risk-taking ability, they have longer tenor for their investments. So unless you see a six-month long bear market which takes indices down 25%, I think the faith will be kept.
Okay, that's very positive, but there is also a debt market issue which we have not discussed. We have to take a break. We are coming back. We have lots more to discuss with the top team from JPMorgan. Stay with us.